Hey, Trinity, New York City, what is going on? Pastor Jimmy Rollins here, and I am so pumped to be with you all today. I believe it's going to be an amazing day. You know why? Because Jesus is in control. And you know why else? It's because you guys have some of the greatest pastors on the planet. Now, before we go into honoring them, I just had this thought this morning as I was preparing for this message for you, Trinity. And it was just like this. You know, I've been fishing and, here in the DMV area, we go out on the bay and I got a good friend who has a boat. And one time we were out on this boat and the storms came. And I'm telling you, I was so nervous. But my friend, who was the captain of this ship, he had two kind of, apparatuses. He had one navigated the storm. It literally talked, and said, what he should do in the storm. And then he had this other, apparatus that was like a fish finder. You know, I've been thinking about coming out of COVID-19. I've been thinking about how hard it's been to navigate church, to navigate the political climate, to navigate even the racial climate, not alone, navigating being quarantined. And I know New York City has been locked down. But I'm so excited that for your church and Trinity Church, that you guys got not just one captain, you have two amazing captains, Taylor and Kristen. And you know what they have? They have an apparatus. They have been connected to a greater source. And that greater source is helping them navigate your church through the storms of COVID-19 and some of the stuff that we just talked about. But I love this other apparatus also. They have this thing called a fish finder. And my buddy, what it does is, it's not deep. It helps find fish. He has this thing to navigate storms and this thing to help find fish. I absolutely love that about your pastors, that they are connected to the Holy Spirit. And guess what? They have not sacrificed finding fish. I mean, that is the vision of your church, to find lost people. And it's amazing that even during a storm, that God can, give you the wherewithal to live out the Great Commission as you navigate the storm and the craziness of COVID and also find more fish. And so I believe that the best days for your church are ahead of you. Listen, I am pumped for this message that I just want to deliver to you today. I hope it blesses you. I want you to really pull your seat up no matter where you're watching this from, and lean in, comment in the comment section, because Trinity, New York City, I believe that God has a word for you. I love this passage of scripture in Matthew 11, 28 and 30. And it says this: "Then Jesus said, 'Come to me, all who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart.'" And I love this next phrase. It's a great promise. When you come to Jesus with your junk, he says, "And you will find rest for your souls." Not rest for your bank account, not just rest for your relationship or your marriage or rest for your, uncertainty in this crazy COVID season, but you will find rest for your souls. I believe that God has something special for you as you lean into finding rest for your soul. It goes on to say this. It says, "For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden that I give you is light." Isn't that amazing about the things of God? Is that we have this opportunity as Christ followers to trade in heavy and hard for easy and light. That is an amazing exchange. Like, you cannot get that exchange rate anywhere else, that we can trade in, that like Jesus sends an RSVP out to a party called Soul Rest. And here's how you get invited. You don't have to have all your I's dotted, all your T's crossed. How you get invited to this party is weariness and heaviness. And what I've come to find out on the other side of being quarantined, come on, Trinity, on the other side of figuring out COVID craziness and all the tension that we have in our country right now, there's nothing better than to trade in heavy and hard for easy and light. I want to highlight that thought by this passage of scripture in the Old Testament. It's found in Jeremiah 6:16. And I love this, because this has been, honestly, my rock during this crazy COVID season. It says this: "This is what the Lord says." This is the prophet Jeremiah, Jeremiah 6:16. "This is what the Lord says: stop at the crossroads and look around." Wow. ask for the old godly way. Travel its path. Travel that path of the old godly way, and what? And you will find rest for your souls. There it is again. Jesus says, come to me, all who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest for your soul. Now here's the prophet Jeremiah in the Old Testament also prophesying and declaring rest for your soul. Trinity, New York City, I want to preach to you today from the topic, soul satisfaction. Soul satisfaction. Not material satisfaction, not just marriage satisfaction, not just church satisfaction or work satisfaction or financial satisfaction, but soul satisfaction. I want rest for my soul. And I'm praying that during this message that God speak to you, that not sleep rest, that, you know, nothing like a good nap, but soul rest. Listen, years ago when I was 16 years old, that was a long time ago. Our family lived in this neighborhood where, you know, all of my friends, I had a group of friends, and all of them had these bicycles that I didn't have. They had something that I didn't have. That bike that they had was called a mongoose. You see, and back in the day, a mongoose was special. Like, you couldn't go to Target or Dick's to get a mongoose. Like, you had to order a mongoose. Mongooses were like the Rolls Royce of bicycles. And all my friends had one, and I didn't. And Christmas time was coming. So what did I do? I made a list and checked it 4 or 5 times, not just twice. And I remember asking my dad, my dad said, what do you want for Christmas this year? I was like, a mongoose. He's like, what's a mongoose? So I began to explain the intricacies of this bike. I'm talking about the pegs on the back so you could, you know, take your feet off the pedals and do a wheelie. I'm talking about the brakes, not on your feet, but the brakes on the handlebars. I wanted a mongoose. Christmas Eve. My dad's like, hey, you need to go to sleep so that I can, you know, so Santa Claus, no, not my dad, he could put together this mongoose. And I'm the kind of, you know, I was the kind of kid that at 12 o'clock midnight, you know, it was still Christmas Eve, but at 12:01, come on somebody, it was a new day. It was Christmas. About 11:30, I could hear my dad putting together this bicycle. And so all this anticipation, at 12:01, I ran out to the tree. It's Christmas. And I saw this bike. And the closer I got to the bike, I got disappointed. I realized it was a bicycle. I realized it could go from point A to point B. I realized it even had the pegs on the back. It even had the brakes on the handlebars. One thing that was wrong, it was not a mongoose. I was disappointed. The bike did everything that my friend's bike did. The problem is it didn't have the name on it. It wasn't a mongoose. It was a knockoff version. We're going to call it a fongoose. Come on, somebody, a fongoose. And so I was disappointed. My dad had sacrificed for me to have this bike. My dad had given everything that he had for me. He put this together uniquely for me. But I was dissatisfied. You know why I was dissatisfied? Because it wasn't what my friends had. It did everything that their bikes did, but it wasn't what they had. So you know what I did? One of my friends had some extra mongoose stickers. I asked them for some stickers. Yep, I did it. And I took those mongoose stickers and I put them all over that bike so I could have what they had. I was not satisfied. I was not satisfied with what I had and what my father had given me because I was so busy looking at what they had. You know what else I did? This is old school. This is going to date me a little bit. I took a clothespin. Some of you don't even know what a clothespin is. And I got a baseball card and I put the clothespin on the spokes so that it sounded, it made this noise and it sounded amazing when I wrote it. It was still a fake mongoose. I was thinking about that. And I realized that many of us on the other side of COVID-19, you know, if you look, stats will say or statistics will say that more people are scrolling and on social media more than ever. More people are on Pinterest and all of these various things more than ever. And I realize that the more I'm focused on what other people have, the less I'm satisfied with what my dad sacrificed to give me. Comparison. Could it be that comparison is the thief of contentment? I believe that comparison is the thief of contentment. I've come to find out that my soul at times gets agitated and has anxiety, not because my dad hasn't given me exactly what I need in life, but because I'm so focused on what everybody else has. I started asking myself this question. I started asking myself the question, could God want to satisfy my soul? Does he have this great exchange of heavy and hard for easy and light, but I can't see it? Or maybe God can't find me because I'm too busy trying to be something I'm not, living something that's not real. And so then what I do is I begin to put stickers all over my life. I begin to strive in areas that I'm not supposed to strive. I begin to, you know, maybe find myself in a job that I never wanted to have because that's what everyone else is doing, or literally comparing my goals to the goals that everyone else has. And I'm telling you, this is a personal message for me. This is a message that I'm still working through. And what I've come to find out is, Jimmy, it is impossible to keep up with who you pretend to be. It's impossible. Trinity, New York, it's impossible for us to keep up with who we pretend to be, what every other church is doing, what every other person is doing, what every other marriage looks like. Maybe you're a teenager and you're on your streaks on Snapchat and your whole life is scrolling and looking at what I'm supposed to wear and what I'm supposed to be and what I'm supposed to do, not realizing Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. For you, Jimmy, for you, Taylor, for you, Christian, for you, Trinity, plans to prosper you, not to harm you. To give you a hope and a future. I believe that this was a critical part for me finding rest for my soul. Is to take the stickers off. Not put stuff on my life just to sound big and to look good. The last thing I want to do is make noise, but not make impact. Soul satisfaction. You see where we find Jeremiah here in Jeremiah chapter 6. Let me first explain what the prophets did. The prophets, they were like God's mouthpiece. Like if God had a megaphone, it would be a prophet. So Jeremiah, he was the one who declared, like I said, like he said, you know, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. He's speaking on behalf of God. And where we find Jeremiah here in Jeremiah 6:16, he's once again speaking on behalf of God. But this kind of message is a warning. This kind of message is listen, guys, you got to get this right. How do I know this? Because as I study this passage of scripture, here are the Israelites. They were God's people, and God had rescued them, from the Egyptians, hundreds of years of slavery. They're on the other side, and they're walking in the promised land, but they're not really in the promise. It's around them, but they can't grab it because they keep sinning. They keep worshiping false idols. God keeps saying, man, you got to do this. They start out doing it, and then it kind of falls by the wayside. And Jeremiah comes with a warning because this time they're about to fight the Babylonians. This is going to be the biggest battle that they've ever faced, the Babylonians. Come on, y'all. Like they're about to get jumped by the Babylonians. I don't know about you, but I've been in a few fights. As a matter of fact, I got jumped once. I was young and talking trash in the wrong neighborhood, and it was like fighting the Babylonians. You know what I was looking for? I was looking for a weapon. You see, when you got a weapon, when you're in a fight, you feel like, you know, you're either going to do some damage or you're going to get out of this thing somehow. So here are the Israelites. They're in the biggest fight that they've ever faced. And Jeremiah says, listen, you're about to face the Babylonians, but I have a weapon for you. I'd have been like, yeah, give me that gun. Give me that bat. Whatever it is, give me that chain. You know, give me fast feet to run. Jeremiah says, no, this weapon is different. You ready? Here's the weapon. Rest. What? We're about to fight? We're on the other side of COVID-19? Our finances are struggling? My marriage is a little jacked up? Come on. Come on, teenagers. Many of you who are seniors in high school, you didn't even get a graduation. And I need a weapon to fight these emotions, to fight this anxiety, to fight this discouragement. And you're telling me to stop? You're telling me to rest? I don't want that weapon. Jeremiah said, you have to realize something. He says, this is not rest for your situation. This is not relief from your situation. This is rest for your soul. I don't know about you, but I've come to discover at 47 years old that I would rather have rest for my soul than relief from my situation. Give me rest for my soul, Jesus, and not relief from my situation. I believe that we got to understand what's at stake. Our soul is at stake. God is concerned about your soul before he's concerned about your situation. What I've come to find out is anxiety and fear and depression and grief and suicidal ideations and all of these things and fear and doubt and discouragement, my emotions are jacked up. And if my emotions are jacked up, I can't hold on to anything spiritually. I can't hold on to physical health. Why? Because I don't have soul health. Well, let me say it this way, because many of us think that we are a body with a soul. We're not a body with a soul. You're a soul with a body. See, when you think that you're a body with a soul, you'll try to take care of your body first before you take care of your soul. How do I know that? Because we look at Genesis 2:7. All the way back in the beginning, when God made us mankind, he says, and the Lord God formed man out of the dust, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living CEO? No. Employee? No. Dad? No. Mom? No. Man became a living soul. I love how that, because the soul unites us. It puts us all in the same category that we need to work on our soul. You see, that word in the Hebrew soul is a word called nephesh. And that word nephesh, it literally means breath of life. You see, when you work on your soul, it's when the Holy Spirit breathes life into lifelessness. He breathes life into anxiety. He breathes life into suicidal thoughts. He breathes life into discouragement. And I love this thought, because when God created man, check it out. Man's very first day of creation, day one, boom, here's man. He didn't go out and strive. He didn't say, now I have all this energy, let's go get some. Let's go do something. Let's go conquer the world. Now, remember that while he was created, God gave him the command to what? To subdue, to have dominion. Come on, somebody. He didn't have an identity yet. He was just man. He didn't have a name. Not really an assignment. But his very first day of creation, you know what he did? He didn't go out and strive. He sat and spent time with his creator. Wow. See, many of us were tired right now. Yeah, and I'm just going to offer this. If you're sleeping, if you take a nap and you still feel like, man, I don't have energy, I want to offer that, you know, you don't need a Red Bull. You don't need a 5-hour energy. You need soul rest. You need your soul satisfied, not your endorphins, not your brain activity. And man became a living soul. You know what I've come to find out in my own life? Is that sleep care, ain't nothing like a nap, is the remedy for tiredness. Ain't nothing like a good nap. Come on, especially a Sunday nap when you're tired. But soul care is the remedy for weariness. Sleep care is the remedy for tiredness, but soul care is the remedy for weariness. What does it profit a man to gain the entire world but lose his soul? So how do we recover? How do we get the breath of life breathed into us? How do we get restored? How do we replenish? How do we reactivate and re-engage in life and marriage and work and parenting and family on this side of COVID? I think Jeremiah, he had a good idea. Jeremiah 6:16, the first thing he said was stop. Stop at the crossroads. Stop. He doesn't say slow down. He says stop. Come on, Trinity. We don't know how to stop. Matter of fact, I don't know about you, but you know, in Maryland, I know a lot of you guys are, you know, you're on the train and you know, in New York City, and you know, you're getting Uber, you know, but you know, I many times when I'm driving and I see a red light or light signal, it may not be red yet, it's green. And then it goes from green to yellow to red. Green means go. You know what I've come to find out in my life? Yellow doesn't mean slow down. Yellow means speed up so that you don't have to stop. I was thinking about that. How many yellow signs has God sent our way in our lives? Hey, guys, slow down. Hey, guys, take a break. Hey, guys, stop strolling. Start worshiping. Stop reading what everything else is going on in everyone else's life and start focusing on me. Yellow light is not really a suggestion to slow down. It's actually a warning that you're about to stop. How about in this phase of life, that before we go out and start trying to conquer again and try to, you know, do the thing and try to get all these followers and try to become these amazing people and these amazing leaders, how about we stop? How about we stop worrying? How about we stop awfulizing how awful things are gonna be? How about we stop shoulding? I should have done this. I should have done that. I should have worked 10 more hours. I should have applied for that job. I should have married that person. I should have dated this person. How about we just stop? Stop. Stop tripping. Stop worrying. Stop not sleeping. Stop complaining. Stop calling everybody else and start calling on Jesus. Stop. I have a quick acronym for stop. The first thing is S. Be still. Still yourself before the Lord. T. Take inventory. Take inventory. Ask yourself, why am I feeling this way? What's going on for me? I did this in counseling in October. Last year, and I was at a crossroads in my life, and I begin to say, like, why am I thinking this? Where is this coming up for me? Is this mine? Is this grief mine? Is this pain mine? Is this doubt mine? Is this discouragement mine? Well, God, do I need to give this back to you? So still myself before the Lord. Take inventory. O is great. Then you can observe God's goodness. Observe what God's done in your life. Observe where you are right now. I think that's a good question. You guys know in the garden when Adam and Eve sinned, the first thing they did was hide. And God asked them a question, where are you? Where are you? Observe, how frustrated are you? What's going on for you? What comes up for you when other people get blessed? And then once you do that, then you can proceed in his presence. S-T-O-P, proceed. Proceed in peace. I'm not talking about peace that's external. I'm talking about internal. Jeremiah first said, stop at the crossroads. You know the second thing you got to do? You want soul satisfaction? First thing you stop. The second thing you do is what? Look around. He said, stop at the crossroads and look around. Ask for the old godly way and walk in it, and you will find rest in your soul. Look around. What did you once call a miracle that now you call mundane? Look around. What did faith birth in one season and now familiarity is robbing in this season? Look around. What has depreciated in value because you no longer appreciate the former victory? Look around. Look around at God's goodness. Look around at God's resume in your life. You know, I love art. And me and my wife, when we go on vacation, we love to find an art gallery. We love to go in a good furniture store that has amazing art and just kind of dream. And you know, what would that picture look like on our wall? And sometimes we'll get a picture and we'll get it delivered to the house. And, you know, my wife says, never pay the people to hang it. I want you to hang it, Jimmy. It's something about me putting a picture up in my house. And so I don't have many tools, and maybe you have tools like I have. I got a trusty butter knife. Come on, somebody. I don't have a great screwdriver. I got one butter knife that I use. Come on, to put peanut butter on bread. Come on, to screw in a screw. Come on, somebody, to scrape some paint off the wall. A butter knife is like a utility, you know, tool. So I was looking for my butter knife, and while I was thinking about it, I was like, man, I got to go to the hardware store and get some wall anchors. So I went to the hardware store and I had to get some anchors to hang the picture up on the wall that we purchased. I got back from the hardware store with those wall anchors that I just bought. Then I went looking for my butter knife. I found my butter knife, and in the drawer with my butter knife was a whole bunch of wall anchors. But Pastor, what? Why did you go out and buy new wall anchors when you already had them? I forgot. I forgot that I had them because I didn't have a picture of my future on the wall. I didn't have something to look at. I didn't have a vision on the wall because I didn't have anchors. And I realized that that wasn't the first time that I went out and bought something that I already had. It was like the fifth time, so I had a drawer full of wall anchors and no picture on the wall. Why? Because I forgot that I already have it. Can I let you know? Can I encourage you, Trinity, New York City, that you already have peace. You already have joy. You already have hope. You don't need to go out and look for it in drinking or look for it in relationships or look for it scrolling through the internet, putting stickers and sounding like you got it all together. You already have Jesus in your boat. Look around. You know that passage of scripture? When Jesus asked the disciples to get in the boat to go to the other side, Jesus takes a nap. He's in the boat. Then a storm comes and the disciples start tripping. We're going to die. Y'all know the story. And Jesus stands up and says, peace, be still. In other words, their fear, their doubt, their anxiety, what it showed them is they forgot what they already had in the boat with them. You don't need to go out and look for something that you already have. You already have peace. And since you already have it, you can put the picture on the wall of a future and a hope and peace. Sometimes you just gotta stop, rest. Say it this way, I believe it. Jesus didn't just speak to the wind and the storm. He also spoke to the disciples and said, peace, be still. If Jesus can go to sleep on a storm, then so can you. Look around. Look at God's faithfulness in your life. Great is thy faithfulness. You know what I love about the things of God? If God gave me grace in a former season, that grace is enough to get me through the next season because God never wastes his grace. Look around and look at God's resume. Look at how faithful he's been. Let me say it this way. If he did it before, if he blessed you before, if he healed you before, if he brought you through before, he'll do it again. Same God right now. It was the same God back then. God hasn't changed. His promises are still yes and amen. Still no weapon formed against you is going to prosper. Jeremiah said, here's the weapon. Stop. Look around. I love this scripture in John 14, 27. He says this, I'm leaving you with a gift. Jesus says, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give you is a gift that the world cannot give you. So don't let your hearts be troubled. Don't be afraid. You don't have to earn peace. You have peace. And can I tell you that peace, it's not the absence of trouble. Peace is not the absence of pain. But peace is the presence of the person of Jesus Christ. Look around, he's with you. His word says, I'll never leave you or forsake you. Stop. Look around. You know what Jeremiah said? Here's the next. Ask for the old godly way. Ask. Ask for the old godly way. Ask. Seek. Knock. Pray. Worship. Get in your word. Ask for God. Ask for the old godly way. Get some wisdom in your life of people who've already been there. My Bible tells me this. It says this. It says, confess your sins to God that you may be forgiven. Confess your sins to one another that you may be healed. Confess your sins to God that you may be forgiven. Confess your sins to people that you may be healed. The problem is we don't trust people. We don't ask anybody for help. We're an island unto ourselves. Or we only talk to people who are going through the same thing as we are. It says, ask for the old godly way. Get some wisdom. Talk to your pastors. Ask. I love that because it just encourages me that no matter what I'm going through, I can bring it to God. I've come to find out that some of us, we're forgiven, but we're not healed because we don't ask for help. I'm telling you right now, if that person is a life raft for me, bring it on. If that person's, you know, a prayer for me is going to help me, bring it on. My son, Jaden, he's about to go off to college. And you know what he is? He is a chronic asker. He's always asking me for something. Hey, Dad, can I get $20? Hey, Dad, can I have $5? Hey, Dad, can I get 10 of my windows? Hey, Dad, can I get rims? Hey, Dad, can I get a new pair of shoes? Hey, Dad, hey, Dad, hey, Dad, hey, can I order DoorDash? Hey, Dad, hey, Dad, hey, Dad, hey. He's always asking something. He's about to go to college. He's about to step into a new phase of life. He's actually going to SCU, where I believe your pastors went, and I'm so excited about that. But you know what he did? He blew my mind last week. He said, Dad, about to go to bed. I said, what's up, huh? What's up, son? He said, what are you doing tomorrow? Now I'm thinking he's going to ask me to take him, so I don't know what he's going to ask. He said, tomorrow I'm chilling, bro. He's like, I was just wondering if we could hang out. I said, what? I wanted to shake him. Who are you? You mean you're not asking for a blessing? You're not asking for a handout? You're not asking for finances? You're not asking for provision? Nah. He said, Dad, can we just hang out? I ain't gonna lie to you. I started crying like a baby. Because I'm gonna miss this guy. And I realized something in that moment. What he didn't realize is, he doesn't realize that if he just asks to spend more time with me, I'll give him whatever he wants. I had a thought. And that thought is, could we be seeking God's hand and provision, and this is what I need, so much, so often, asking for stuff that we don't seek his face and who he is? Could we be asking out of worry that we never ask to spend time to worship him? I wonder if God is in heaven sometimes saying, I wish they would stop asking for stuff and start asking for me. I wish they would stop worrying and start worshiping. You ever felt like you lost your identity? You know what I've come to find out? That identity is found in intimacy with your Creator. Man, that day Jaden spent time with me, and I just began to bless him. Not because he wanted it, but because I wanted to give it to him. When's the last time you asked for margin, or you had margin just to spend time with God? You know, when I was in elementary school, a kid with ADHD, I never paid attention during class, but I would doodle in the margin. That little side on the paper, it'd have notes, it'd have pictures, it'd have girls' name. Come on, somebody that I wanted to ask out. I'd write in the margin. Not only did I write in the margin when I was in elementary school, you know what I've come to find out as a grown man? God speaks in the margin. He writes his heart in the margin of your life. I don't believe that God has never stopped speaking. But maybe we don't have enough margin to listen to what he's doodling in the margin. That weapon, ask. He says, stop. He says, look around. Jeremiah says, ask. You know what the last thing he says? And I love this. He says, now walk its path. Travel that path. Walk. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like seas billows roll, whatever my lot, that was taught me to say, it is well with my soul. You can't have a well soul running. You gotta slow down. You gotta walk. You know, when you read the Gospels, you know what we never see? Jesus did a lot in 3.5 years of ministry. You know what we never see him doing? In a hurry. Running. I don't believe that the enemy has to break us down to take us out. He actually just has to speed you up. Could the antidote to my worry and grief and anxiety be just to slow down and walk? It's crazy to me that even David in Psalms 23 says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. It doesn't say, yea, though I hurry. Come on, he's facing the shadow of death and he says, I'm walking. I was in counseling in October. I love counseling. I encourage everybody to go to counseling. And I remember the counselor, he was like, hey, I want you to read your favorite scripture right now. And I was reading Psalms 43, and it said this: why, my soul, are you downcast? Why are you disturbed within me? This is Psalms 43:5. Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior, my Lord, my God. He said, read it again. I said, why, my soul, are you downcast? He said, no. I want you to slow down. I said, why, my soul, are you downcast? He said, no, slower. Read one word at a time. And I just said, why? I said, why are you doing this? I'm paying you. Come on, somebody. I know you're getting paid by the hour. He said, no, I want you to read God's word slowly. Matter of fact, I want you to stop reading God's word. I said, oh my God. He goes, no, because when you slow down, you allow God's word to read you. Why? Why am I tripping? Why am I worrying? Why am I here? How did I get to this space? You see, when you slow down, Psalms 43, 5, why? The next words I read was my soul. Why my soul? My soul? My soul is at stake. Not my reputation, my soul. I got a sticker on that area of my life. That's really not who I am, my soul. Why my soul? Are you downcast? I love when I read this in the NIV, downcast as a question mark. Downcast? Really? I'm sure God's like, downcast? After all I've done for you, you're downcast? You're in your right mind, downcast? I've protected you and see nothing seasons. Downcast, Jimmy? Really? See, when you slow down, you don't read God's word. It begins to read you. I love the word next. It says so. Why so disturbed? So. You know when you read so slowly, when you walk? So. Why am I so worried? Why do I have so much anxiety? Why am I so tripping? Why am I so empty? Because the next line says, put your hope in God. Put. In other words, I got to take it out of stuff. I got to redefine significance. I got to redefine the win. You know what I've come to find out? That my hope was in my finances. My hope was in what I can provide. And I don't know about you, is I didn't make me, God did, so I'm not responsible for me. I don't have the ability to respond to the things of life that I can't control, only God does. I'll say it this way. I think we need to get our hands out of God's plans for your life, for my life. Put your hope in God. Jeremiah gives you a weapon. He says, stop, look around, ask, and walk. Crazy thing is if you read the next chapter, the Israelites ignored it. And they ended up in more turmoil. Man, why so downcast? Oh, my soul. Jesus says, come to me. All who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest for your soul. Soul satisfaction. Trinity, let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for these amazing people in this amazing church. And I ask right now, God, that in this moment, they just hang out with you. To give them peace beyond their own understanding. Bless them. Today, we trade in heavy and hard for easy and light. Trinity, New York City, I love you. Until next time, soul satisfaction.